First International Baptist Church of Trenton, New Jersey. The church where everybody is somebody and Christ is head. This is a warm welcome to join us for our Rhema Encounter. A time of spirit-empowered, inspirational, practical, and participatory engagement with the Word of the Living God. Rhema Encounter is about cultivating the grace to hear God's Word, God's Rhema, for our lives, our walk, and our faith. Join our pastor, the Reverend Victor G. Cohn, for an exciting time in the Word. Thanks for tuning in. Please share this video and do stay tuned. God bless you.
Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, praise the name of Jesus the Christ. Hallelujah. I don't know if you are as excited as I am to be here today for this edition of our Rhema Encounter, but I am really, really, really excited. I am expecting God to do amazing things. Amen. I'm expecting God to do amazing things tonight through our time of teaching. Hallelujah. So we are grateful. We are grateful to God for this time that we can gather. We can come together to just study the Word of God together. Study the Word of God together. Amen. So please, as usual, we can ask you, I mean, we would like to ask you to just share this link, share this video, and encourage others to join us, encourage others to tune in. Today, we are on a third part of our discussion of accessing the glory of God, the third part of accessing the glory of God, and you don't want to miss it. So please join us to share this link, share this video in Jesus' name. Yeah. We don't have copyright to this song. This is a song by Chris Morgan, Daily As I Live, Hallowed Be Thy Name. We don't have copyright to this song. But we just want to use this to start our time tonight.
hope tonight as I breathe, and my whole life expressions of your grace.
We don't have copyright to this song. This is a song by Chris Morgan. Yes, Lord.
Often as I breathe, let my whole life be expressions of your grace. Daily as I live, often as I breathe, let my whole life be expressions of your grace. Somebody say, often as I breathe, and my whole life be expressions of God's grace.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord.
Daily as I live, often as I breathe, my whole life be expressions of your grace. We cry, Abba Father, hallowed be your name. Hallowed be your name. Hallowed be your name. We cry, Abba Father, hallowed be your name. Hallowed be your name. Hallowed be your name.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Jesus. Hallelujah. Help us to share this link. Encourage others to join us. Tonight we're discussing accessing the glory of God, accessing God's glory. This is the third installment of this presentation. Please help us to share this link. Yes, Lord. Yes, Jesus.
Often as I breathe, let your whole life be expressions of your grace.
If you're on Facebook and you look at the title of this broadcast, you should be able to see a link there that says to participate. Click on this link, and we want to encourage you to please click on that link so that your comments can be directly shared in the video. We appreciate you if you can do that for us, please. Just click on this link, the https://faq. vlive.tv/group comments. Just please click on that link for us, and it's gonna authorize us, it's gonna give us authorization to share your comments directly in the feed. Amen. So please do that for us.
Hallowed be your name. Hallowed be your name. We cry, Abba Father, hallowed be your name. Hallowed be your name. Hallowed be your name.
Yes, Lord. You know, when we're trying to enjoy this song, that kind of probably bring all kinds of effort. They want to encourage us to sign up for YouTube Red, but no, we ain't going to. You'll get hit.
Yes, hallowed be your name. Hallowed be your name.
Yes, Lord. Yes, Jesus.
We cry, Abba Father, hallowed be your name. Hallowed be your name. Hallowed be your name.
Thank you, Jesus. Thank you, Jesus. We give you glory tonight. We bless you tonight. We give you glory 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 tonight. We thank you for who you are. We give you glory tonight. We thank you for who you are. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Hallelujah. Yes. 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 Okay, we are so grateful to God. We are so grateful to God for each of you that are commenting. Again, what we're trying to do is we're trying to get your comments to be directly on the screen. So I'm going to paste it also as a comment, and I hope that you can, you will kindly click
on. Praise the Lord, praise the Lord, praise the Lord.
You will kindly click on there to give us permission to just share your comments. There it is. There it is. So I see a couple of comments. I see a couple of comments from Sister Selena Roberts, Brother JB Bayan, Sister Weta Pine. I see a couple of comments from Sister James Etter Gittins. So yeah, I just put a link in the comment section. If you click on there and give them permission, once you comment, your comments will be shared directly in our presentation, and that's what we want to do. So please do that for us. Please do that for us. Praise the Lord. We're discussing tonight. So this is pretty much how it's going to look. You will see it like this. As you see on the screen right now, you see to participate, click on this. So yes, if you give permission, your comments will directly, it will not just be on the Facebook Live, on the Facebook comment, but it will also directly be shared in our presentation. All right. So please do that for us. And we thank you. We thank you for doing that.
Your name, hallowed be your name, hallowed be your name.
We bless you, Jesus. We bless you, Jesus. Accessing the glory of God, accessing God's glory. That's the focus of our discussion for tonight. That's the discussion, the topic for our discussion tonight. This is the third part. This is the third part of this presentation. And we are grateful to God for granting us another opportunity to be here. Unfortunately for us, last week we were unable to be here because of some circumstances beyond our control. But thanks be to God who has granted us another opportunity to be here. We count this a privilege. This is not a right for us to sit before you and to handle the counsel of the Word of God. This is not a right, this is a privilege. This is the greatest privilege that anyone can have on the face of the earth, to be called and set apart by God as a servant of His to proclaim God's Word. And so we are grateful, we are truly grateful to God tonight for this honor, for this privilege that we have. I just wanna extend thanks to Favor Duo for my Mighty Man of War t-shirt. As you can see, I love it. It's so beautiful. Yeah, I told her it was hard to make a selection because she has the white, the red, the black, and of course the navy blue, but I think the navy blue suits me well. She made a really good selection. Yeah, so we thank God for her, for Sister Duo. Thank God for Sister Duo. Yes, help us just share the link. Just share the link and encourage others to join us, and then as we will start in a minute or two from now, I'm also sharing. I'm also sharing the link to encourage others to join us, and we'll start in any minute from now. Praise the Lord. Praise the Lord. Jesus is worthy. The Lord Jesus is worthy of our praise. Jesus is worthy. Jesus is worthy. The Lord Jesus is worthy. Jesus is worthy. The Lord Jesus is worthy. 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 Thank you. All right, so we're going to do a few bars of Sister Duos. Sister Duos, Mighty Man of War. Amen. Yes, Jesus is worthy. Hallelujah.
Mighty Man of War. Mighty Man of War. You are the mighty man of war. Mighty man of war. You are the mighty man of war. Mighty man of war. You are the mighty man of war. You're fighting a battle. You're fighting a battle. Fighting a battle.
Yes, Lord Jesus. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Jesus. Hallelujah. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Yes, Lord. Hallelujah, Jesus. Jesus, you are Lord. You are Lord. Okay, so what we want to do, we want to begin first by going to God in prayer. It's pretty important. It's pretty important that we engage God. I like the way the psalmist puts it in Psalm 119, verse 18, when he says, "Open thou my eyes, that I may behold, that I may see, that I may access the wondrous things out of the law of the Lord. Open thou my eyes, that I may behold wondrous things out of the law of the Lord. Open my eyes, God, that I may behold wonderful things out of your word." I pray and hope this will be our desire tonight, that God will open our eyes so that we can access the things that God has a portion for us from God's word tonight. In Jesus' name, let us talk to God. Gracious God, we are privileged, we are blessed, we are honored. We are so thankful for this day that you've given to us, this midweek, this time that we can congregate before the presence of the Lord by means of technology, but God, to feed on your word. We don't count this opportunity lightly. We take it seriously. And God, we thank you that, God, we are mere vessels. We are just the instruments that you can use because you are the teacher. So, Spirit of God, we avail ourselves to you in this moment, and we ask you to just glorify Jesus. Father God, we consciously choose to decrease, and we pray that, Lord, you will increase. And that those of your people, God, who are participating in this time of study tonight will be mighty blessed, will be mighty encouraged, mighty strengthened. There will be a word for somebody tonight that will change the dimensions of their experience and launch them deeper into you, oh God, into the ocean of who you are. Thank you, Lord, tonight for your presence. Thank you, Lord, for your power. It is all that makes the difference, oh God. In Jesus' name. Amen. 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 All right. So we're talking about accessing the presence, accessing the glory of God. And our text is, of course, if you've been following us over the past few weeks, you know that our text is Leviticus, the ninth chapter, Leviticus chapter 9, verse 1 to 6. And then we skip on to the last two verses 23 and 24. So it reads like this. 8 days later, Moses called Aaron, his sons, and the elders of Israel. He told Aaron, "Take a young calf for a sin offering and a ram without defects for a whole burnt offering and bring them into the Lord's presence." He also told the Israelites, "Bring a male goat for a sin offering, a calf, a year old lamb without defects for a whole burnt offering, an ox, a ram for a peace offering to sacrifice in the Lord's presence, and a grain offering with olive oil, because on that day the Lord will appear
to you. Verse 5. So they brought what Moses had commanded to the tent, to the entrance of the tent of meeting. The entire congregation drew near and stood in the Lord's presence. Verse 6, which is our key verse. Then Moses said, this is what the Lord commanded you to do. Why? So that the glory of the Lord may be revealed unto you. So that the glory of the Lord may be revealed unto you. Skip down to verses 23 and 24. And there it says, and Moses and Aaron entered the tent of meeting. When they came out, they blessed the people, and the glory of the Lord appeared to all the people. Verse 24. A fire came down from the Lord's presence and consumed the burnt offering on the altar as well as the fat. When the people saw it, they shouted and they fell on their faces. They shouted and they fell on their faces. Accessing the glory of God. When we started this presentation a few weeks ago, we took our time to explain to you that what is going on here in the text is that there is a transfer of the priestly function from Moses, and it's now being passed on to Aaron and to his sons. We also explained to you the primary difference between the role, the function of a priest, and the primary function of a prophet. We said a priest's sole responsibility is to represent, to ably represent, to offer an acceptable representation of the people to God. In simple terms, the priest is one who stands ready as a representation for the people, and he stands between the people and God. The priest stands in a gap between the people and God. The prophet, on the other hand, we says, has the primary function of representing God to the people. In other words, the prophet is the mouthpiece for God. The prophet hears from God, and the prophet speaks to the people on behalf of God. The prophet is more or less like an emissary, like one who comes with a message from the very heart of God and who declares the principles, the decrees, and the intention of God to the people of God. All right, so it's important to know these distinctions. But we came to the place of also telling you that when you look at all of the requirements, because it took, the text begins by saying on the eighth day. And we said that, you know, when you're reading the Bible and you come across a phrase like that on the eighth day, it's out of curiosity. You should develop, by the grace of God, I pray that you develop, you know, the mindset, you will develop the habit of wanting to know what was going on, to develop a kind of curiosity or kind of hunger to want to go back into the text to find out what was happening. And if you go back to chapter 8, you will notice that the priests, Aaron and his sons, who are being consecrated, who are being ordained for the priestly office, these guys have gone through a consecration process of 7 whole days. It had taken them 7 days to go through the consecration process. So now, and if you notice, for those 7 days, they were offering a lot of sacrifices. They were going through a whole lot of rituals just to prepare them to assume this responsibility, just to prepare them to step into this place of serving God and serving the people of God. You know, so when you think about all of that, and you think about all the huge responsibilities it entailed for them to serve as priests before God, you know, you want to wonder today, then, who qualifies to be a priest? But Jesus Christ, the scripture tells us, is our great high priest in heaven. And because of the intercession of Jesus, and because of the effective ministry of Jesus, who is not just the Lamb of God whose blood was shed for the redemption of humanity, but because of the effective work that Jesus is doing today, we are also created in the family of God to also be priests unto God. In other words, we are, Jesus Christ brings us into the kingdom. He brings us into his family so that we then can stand in a gap between God and the people who have no relationship with God. So we have a priestly function as well. We have a priestly function as well. Now, we also took it a step further. I'm just trying to do a quick recap just to make sure we are all on the same page. We also went and did a quick recap, and we told you that one critical aspect of accessing the presence of God, if you look at the text specifically, Moses lists 7 specific sacrifices that Aaron and his sons and the people of Israel, they are supposed to present before God. And then he says, this is what God commanded you to do. Verse 6 of Leviticus 9. This is what God commanded you to do. God commanded you to sacrifice so that through the medium of sacrifice, the glory of the Lord will be revealed unto you. And so we said, as we started our presentation, we said that if we must access the glory of God, then it's important that we too have the mindset of not coming before the Lord empty. You know, it's important to know, it's important to be reminded that, yes, we go to God for everything. Yes, because God is the source of our supply. Yes, God is our Father. Yes, Jesus taught us to pray and say, you know, give us this day our daily bread. And nothing's wrong with going to God to get from God. Nothing's wrong with going to God to ask from God. But it's important that when you go to God, we should go to God with a sense of, you know, giving to God as well. We should not just want to go to God for what we can get from God, but we should come with a mindset before God of what we can give to God. And so we said, if we want to grow in accessing the presence of God, we should learn to also cultivate a habit of giving to God, of sacrificing, of offering something unto God. All right. And so today again, we're talking about we're taking it a step further. But again, as we start this presentation today, as we begin this presentation today, we just want to begin by saying that this subject of the glory of God, like everything else, any idea of God, any idea about God, any concept of God is as profound, is as multifaceted, and is as deep as God himself. Can I say that again? All right, let me say that again. Any idea about God that we somehow gain, maybe through the Holy Spirit inspire us, or maybe by inspiration we get some idea of God, any idea of God is as deep and multifaceted and compounded and complex and difficult and hard to understand, just as God himself is so huge and unfathomable, we can't fully wrap our minds around God. And that idea includes the idea of the glory of God. When we talk about the glory of God, it's not just something that you can just, you know, we can just grab and just run with. Like, you know, it's something that we can easily just fully understand, wrap our heads around it, and just say, oh, yeah, I got this, and you run with it. Now, I'm not saying this to say that God wants to complicate things for us. No, I'm saying it because, you know, before we go deep, I'm saying this because I want us to focus on a few things about God. That God is just beyond anything that we know as human beings. And therefore, everything concerning God is as complex. And yet, God has a way of making God's self approachable. God has a way of making God's self accessible. God has a way of making God's self available to God's people, and especially to anyone who really, 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 really wants to have a taste of God. Now, the Bible can say, oh, taste and see that the Lord is good, right? So if anyone really, really has a taste, has a hunger for God, like the psalmist would say in Psalm 42, he says, as the deer thirst for the waters, so my soul thirsts for you. If anyone has a true thirsting and a true longing for God, God wants to make God's self known to you. That's a promise. Now, just before we go deeper into the focus of our study for today, there are a few beautiful things I want to remind you about. Beautiful things I want to remind you about. All right. The first one is that. The first thing I want us to be reminded of is this. You know, the reason why ideas about God, like the glory of God and all these things, the reason why these things are so difficult and so complex and so, you know, hard to understand is because the very God that we serve is an awesome God. The very God that we serve is an infinite God. The very God that we serve is an unlimited God. Not only that God is unlimited, but the God I'm talking about is a God who is unlimitable. This God cannot be limited. This God is incontestable. There is no one who can compete with God and win. My God, this God I'm talking about is unconquerable. This God I'm talking about, somebody sing about him and they call him an able God. When John is speaking about him, John calls him the faithful and the true God. Right. So because this God is unfathomable, because this God is so inexhaustible. We cannot fully exhaust the grandiosity of God, you know. And even if you were to get all the dictionaries in the world and you gather up all the philosophers combined to try to exhaust words to define God, to find adjectives to just capture to define the grandiosity, the splendor, and the unfathomability of God, the sheer greatness of God, guess what? They will run out of words to express and to declare the depth and the riches of God. Because this God is an awesome God. This God is a huge God. Like the way Paul writes it in Romans chapter 11 and verse 33, he says, oh, the depth of the riches and the wisdom and the knowledge of God. He said, how unsearchable are God's judgments and how inscrutable are the ways of God, my God. So the first thing I want to remind you of is the reason why ideas about God, concepts about God, they are complex. It's because God is an unlimited God. This is the first reason. So remind yourself of that. You know, if you try to study something about God and it's a little bit confusing and it's giving you a little bit problem, you know, there are two ways that people could respond. Some people get frustrated and they, you know, stop pursuing after God. But other people learn the habit of learning to rest and say, okay, I'm going to give it a break. I'm going to take some time. I'm going to rest, but I'm going to get back on this thing. Because again, those who truly have hunger and those who truly have a thirsting for God, you know, as you continue to pursue after God, God will make God's self known to you, right? So first of all, remind yourself when you're getting frustrated about how complex, you know, the things of God is, remind yourself that God is unlimitable. God is awesome, all right? That's the first thing to remind yourself of. But the second thing to remind yourself of is this, and this is the beautiful thing I like about God, is that God has never set a full and a perfect understanding of God as a prerequisite for a relationship with God. Can I say that again? There is no place in scripture where God says that if you don't have a full and a perfect understanding of God, you cannot have a relationship with God. No, there is, you will never find it in the Bible. Because you see, God understands that we have different levels of understanding. We have different levels of maturity. We have different levels of seeing things. We have different levels of accessing things. And so for this reason, God does not make it a standard and say, if you don't fully understand me perfectly, then don't come to me. I don't want to have anything to do with you. Stay over there. Be by yourself. No, this is not God. In fact, one of the friends of Job, he is revealing the unsearchableness of God. He reveals a very powerful theological truth about God, although the context in which he's using that is wrong, because he's saying that Job cannot claim to be right with God because, you know, Job doesn't know where God is, and Job has sinned. And in fact, Job deserves worse than what Job is going through because his condition is a result of sin. And this is what he says. The text says in Job chapter 11, verse 7 to 10, this guy says, Zophar, he says, can you find out the deep things of God? Can anyone find out the deep things of God? Can you find out the limits of the Almighty? The deep things of God, the things of the Almighty, the limits of the Almighty, he said, they are higher than the heavens. What can you do? They are deeper than the grave. How can you know it? He said, it is measured longer than the earth, and it is measured broader than the sea. And if you pass through, and he passes through and imprisons and summons the courts, and when he does that, who can turn back God's hand? So he's again revealing to us that God is unsearchable in all of God's ways. But although God is unsearchable, there is nowhere that God says that if you don't fully understand him, then you can't come to him. All I'm saying in short is we don't have to fully understand God to desire to want to be in the presence of God. As a case in point, the guy who is hanging on a cross with Jesus, the one thing he says today, he said, Lord, remember me when you come in your kingdom. Jesus didn't say, go back and go study Sunday school. He didn't say, go back and go read the Bible. He says to him, today you will be with me in paradise, right? So he said, the first truth that we need to be reminded of is that when you find it difficult to understand the things of God, that's because God is unsearchable, right? The second thing we said, well, although God is unsearchable, God does not say that if we don't have a perfect understanding of God, we should not come to God. All right. And now the third thing I want to remind you of is this. Although God does not say that if you don't have a perfect understanding of God and you don't have a complete understanding of God, then you can't come to God. Although God doesn't say that, God also expects that those who truly love God will be intentional in seeking after him. It's hard. difficult to understand a lot of things about God. But you see, this is a test. This becomes a test because the people who truly love God will not give up. They will continue to press hard after God. Again, remember, now the psalmist says, as a deer thirsts for the water. If you're thirsty for something, you keep going after it. You keep going after it. If you're really hungry for something, if you really want to get a taste of God, to see and to know that God is good, you don't just try on your first attempt, and because you can't understand it, you can't wrap your head around it, you just throw the Bible away and you just close it up and say, well, you know, God, I don't want to be bothered with this. No, this is not true. About it. And I mean, having said that, we also know that, guess what? There are some people today who have no desire to pursue after God. They just have no interest in wanting to grow deeper into the things of God. All right. But the pressing heart after God is an indication that we love God. Jesus says, if you love me, keep my commandments, right? It's in John chapter 14 and verse 15, right? All right. I mean, loving God, part of loving God means loving God with our mind, with our understanding. We want to bring our minds. We want to learn to know the mind of God. We want to learn to know the heart of God so that we will not lean on our own understanding. So we can acknowledge God so that God will direct our path. And when God is directing our path, we can be sure this is the Lord leading us, because we know that this thing, you know, this opportunity that I have is consistent with the way that God works. All right. So I want to make sure to establish those three things. Now, today, when we think about our, also, I want to also say this, when we think about our unworthiness, right? When we think about the fact that we often fail God, our common failings, right? Isn't it easy then to sometimes doubt whether God is interested in us, whether God is really interested in us? Isn't it easy for us to, you know, doubt whether our seeking after God really matters? I think it's possible. But here's the thing. The truth of the matter is that plus or minus our limits, right, and our shortcomings, God, in God's perfection, God wants to be found. God wants to be found. If God did not want to be found, first of all, God wouldn't constantly come to Adam and Eve in the cool of the day. You say, well, but that was before the fall, and so sin has happened. But again, you constantly see God showing up in the lives of different people. You constantly see God sending angels to show up in the lives of people and call them into God's service. Why is God doing that if God does not want to be found? So, yes, God wants to be found. God wants God's glory to be revealed to us. God wants us to access God. God wants us to enjoy God. God wants us to benefit from all the fullness of what the presence of God offers. All right. Too often than not, here's the thing. When God covers, or when God seems to be covering up God's self, it's not because God doesn't want to show God's self to us. Because perhaps, you know, somebody might be thinking, yeah, but Pastor Cohn, you know, if God so loves us and if God wants to be found, why is it that it's so hard to find God? I seek after the Lord, and I'm searching after God, and I want to know what God's will is, you know, concerning this situation in my life, concerning my health, concerning my finances, concerning my relationship, or concerning a relationship I'm anticipating on getting into. Why does it seem like God is not talking to me? Why is it that God is not revealing, you know, God's self to me? When that is the case, I've learned that God is not doing it because God wants to hide God's self from us. No, but because God lacks the desire to want to show God's self to us. Rather, God is doing that as a reflection of grace. Because oftentimes, the presence and the glory of God can be devouring and can be destructive and devastating, especially when you access the presence of God with the wrong mindset, with the wrong condition of the heart. It can be devastating. Because God is holy. Remember, Moses has committed murder. Moses has killed this Egyptian. Moses is now, his life has been haunted. Moses has escaped Egypt. He's in Midian. He's taking care of, you know, of his father-in-law's cattle around a mountain. And there, God shows up in his life. God shows up in his life on a mountain. And you know, God reveals God's self to, excuse me. Exodus chapter 33. I'm trying to get it right. Exodus chapter 33. So by this time, Moses is leading Israel, right? And they're in a wilderness. And through a dialogue one day, Moses and God is having this dialogue, this exchange. And Moses prays this radical prayer. He says, God, show me your glory, I pray. Exodus 33, verse 18. God, show me your glory. Show me your glory, God. God responds to Moses by saying to him, I will make my glory pass before you. In other words, the glory of God is something that can be perceived. It can be seen, in a sense. Because if God says, I'm going to cause my glory to pass before you, it's something that Moses was going to see. And now, obviously, when you think about Moses, you realize that Moses had seen the glory of God in different ways. He had seen God showing up. He had seen a person of God in many different ways. But this was going to be another level of exposure, another level of manifestation of the glory of God. He says, so God says to him, I will make my glory pass before you. In other words, you will see my glory. And then the Lord says, and I will proclaim, meaning I will call out to you, I will announce, I will explain to you the name of the Lord. I will explain to you Yahweh, because here it is. During those days, back in the day, the concept was that if you knew the name of someone you were interacting with, you could have influence with them. You could have favor with them. You could call them by their name. And when you call them by their name, you know, you could, they would know that there was a level of intimacy between your level of intimate relationship. And then you could lean on them and they could do whatever you had, maybe you were requesting for. So when God says to Moses, I'm going to show you my glory, or I'm going to cause you to see my glory, and I'm going to proclaim my name to you, God is saying to Moses, I am going to bring you into a deeper exposure of who I am, so that you will see and that you will understand, you will hear and understand and know who I am. This is God speaking to Moses. All right. The question to us today is, you know, do we yearn to see more of God? Do we yearn to see more of God? Do we yearn to have God reveal to us who God is? I'm not talking about what the theologians say about God. I'm not talking about, you know, what we have read about God. I'm not talking about what we have heard in songs about God. But personally, do we make time to sit before God and say, God, I want to see your glory? But God ended by saying to Moses, my face you cannot see, for no man can see my face and live. All right. And then the Lord continued by saying, see, there is a place in the rock where you will stand on the rock. And while my glory passes by, I will put you in a cleft of the rock and I will cover you with my hands until I have passed by. And then I will take away my hand and you will see my back, but my face you shall not see. Exodus 13, beginning of verse 19 through 23. So you see, the idea of the glory of God is a very important subject for the body of Christ today. It's important. It's a huge but also important subject. The people of God need to understand the glory of God. First, because the glory of God, you know, is so it's important. I want to stress that it's important for us to understand the glory of God, right? Now, when it comes to the glory of God, the first thing I want us to understand about the glory of God is that the glory of God is that perceivable manifestation of God that will let you know that, you know, that it will be a clear mark, a clear attribute that the presence of God is here. When the glory of God is manifested, and when the glory is revealed, is shown, is uncovered, it's like when the curtain is open, and you're able to look beyond and see what the glory is. Once you see the glory, once you perceive the glory, once you access the glory, you will also know that the presence of God is there. The glory of God is never separated from the presence of God. So the glory of God is never separated from the presence of God. So when you think about the glory of God, one thing you want to think about is you want to think about the presence of God. And this presence, you know, based on scripture is indescribable beauty. It's indescribable beauty. Look at how the Bible writers try to find words to describe the presence. And they'll say, I saw a wheel in the middle of the wheel. They'll say, I saw the throne, and the throne was like this. They'll say, I saw one whose hair was as white as snow and whose eyes were like this and whose skin was as bronze. Indescribable. You've never seen beauty before until you see the beauty of the Lord. My God, we have never seen beauty until you come to see deeper realms of the beauty of the Lord. So the glory of the Lord is that indescribable beauty, is that indescribable brilliance, that display of raw power, that presentation of complete splendor and majesty, the glory of God. But on the other hand, the glory of God is also depicted as weight, you know, like quantity, like greatness, like heaviness. And I think, you know, when you see a word used in the Bible, and defined as weighed. You know, the word for glory, when you find that word defined as weighed, sometimes it makes me wonder whether, because of the glory of God, that is why when people accessed it, when people experienced it, really truly experienced the presence of God, experienced the glory of God, they're not able to stand on their feet and look at God, you know, like two equals. They fall on their faces before God. Because the glory of God can be overwhelming. The glory of God is the expression of raw greatness, of indescribable power and greatness and majesty and authority. I'm reminded of Joshua chapter 5, verse 13 through 15, where Joshua is going to Jericho. He's preparing to go and attack Jericho by the command of the Lord. And the scripture says when he gets close to Jericho, he sees a man in full military regalia, full military armor, dressed and armed to the teeth, because the scripture says he has a sword drawn. And when Joshua sees this guy, he asks the question, hey, are you for us or are you against us? The man says, neither am I for you or against you, but I am the captain of the Lord of hosts army. When Moses and when Joshua encounters this guy, when he encounters this person, he realizes that he is standing in the presence of majesty, and the scripture says that he falls on his face because of the weight, the heaviness of the glorious presence that he's in. Glorious presence that he's in. I feel important. I feel there is a very important point I need to stress here today. When the man says, I am neither for you, nor am I against you, I am the captain of the Lord of Hosts Army. Too often we try to box God into our political affiliations and political connections. Republicans will say God is for us. Democrats will say God is for us. And this political party will say, no, God is not for any political. You can't box God in. You can't box God in. And this is the reason why when we try to use God and we try to box God into our corners of affiliation, then it means that we think that we can gain the right, the legitimacy to do any kind of thing that is wrong and claim that we got a blessing of God. We can get God to bless our mess. No, God doesn't come to take sides. God comes to take over. We must recognize the place of God and recognize our presence on our knees and on our face before God in his majesty and his presence, because it's not about the donkey. And it's not about the elephant, but it's about the Lion of Judah and the Lamb of God slain before the foundation of the world. It's important, because sometimes you watch the political discourse and the political discussions today, and it's almost like everybody trying to claim God in their little corner. No, you can't box God in. It's not about us trying to squeeze God into our little corners. It's about us learning to discover who God is and what God is revealing to us about who God is and how God wants us to treat each other and how God wants us to love God and walk in holiness. This is the place of the church today. Because if the church does not stand her ground and stay in her place, the church will water down her influence and nobody will want to respect the God that we serve. Oh, but far be it from God that God's glory will not be revealed. Because the scripture is clear. Paul writes to Timothy, 2 Timothy 2 and verse number 19, when he says, nevertheless, the foundation of God stands sure, having this seal, the Lord knows those who belong to him. And let everyone who is called by the name of the Lord depart from iniquity. Praise the Lord. So the glory of God can also be depicted as weight, as heaviness, you know, which often causes us, when we truly access the presence of God, we recognize our sense of unworthiness and we fall prostrate before the Lord and say, Lord, you are worthy. You are great. You are glorious. You are mighty. The glory of the Lord can also be revealed as brightness, as this brilliance, this light, this fire. You know, God led Israel, the glory of the Lord led Israel as a pillar of cloud by day, as a pillar of fire by night. In the New Testament, the scripture says when Saul is going to persecute Christians on Damascus, when he sees this light, this indescribable light shining from heaven, brighter than the sun, bright, something that a brightness he had not seen before, and he falls from his horse. Hence the expression falling from your high horse. Because he thought he had authority and position and power until he encountered God and the glory of God, and he had to fall off his horse. I'm talking about the glory of God as the brightness and the splendor of God, I could tell you about Moses. You know, when Moses is in chapter 19, when Moses is on Mount Sinai and he tells the people of God, you know, get ready and stand at the foot of the mountain because the Lord will reveal God's self to you. And when the Lord comes and God reveals God's self on by touching foot on the mountain of Sinai, the scripture says there is blazing fire and there is thick smoke and darkness, and there is thunder and peals of lightning, and there's a great trumpet that is indicative of majesty, and the Israelites are terrified about the glorious presence and the glorious majesty of God. One that makes us realize that we are unworthy of this presence. You know, and the truth of the matter is, instead of our sense of unworthiness driving us away, God wants us to still recognize our unworthiness, but to still come to God and say, Lord, make me a vessel. Make me an offering. Make me whatever you want me to be. The word glory in the Old Testament comes from the Hebrew word kabod, and it represents, in a more concrete sense, it represents fullness. Fullness. So when God's presence, when God's glory is revealed, the glory of God reveals, depicts that God is perfection, that God is fullness, that God is lacking in nothing. So when we access the glory of God, we are accessing fullness. We're accessing the fullness of everything there is, the fullness of everything that will ever be, the fullness of God, the fullness of God's presence. That's what the glory of God represents. The scripture also affirms that God's glory is made known through the work of creation, right? Because you're here in Psalm chapter 19, verse 1, the heavens, that is the works of God's hands, you know, the heavenly bodies, declare what the glory of the Lord, they announce that God is glorious. Because again, the glory of God can also be the power of God. So that just looking at the splendor of the beauty of creation, it tells you that God has power, that God has brilliance, that God has intelligence to cause the sun to be 93 million miles away from the earth. And if the earth was a little closer, we would burn up. So we just have the right trajectory, just at the right angle. And the earth has been going around, revolving around the sun for centuries, for millennia, and the earth have not slipped off its course. This is brilliance. This is marvelous intelligence. This is marvelous intelligence. And all this shows how glorious God is. But not only through creation do we see the glory of God, we also see the glory of God in redemption. That is, God created a marvelous species, a marvelous creation, humanity. We fell into sin. And, there was no hope for us. Our foreparents were trying to mend the gap by themselves. They were trying to make a cloak of skin. They were trying to make a cloak of fig leaves to wear to hide their nakedness from God. And God comes on the scene and God, you know, deals with the situation. But ultimately, God clothed them with animal skin, implying that God is the one who offers the first sacrifice. God offers the first sacrifice, all right? So in a redemptive work of God, we also see the glory of God. In God intervening in history, when God intervenes in history, when God intervenes like the sending of God's son in the person of Jesus Christ, we see then the glory of God on display. When God intervenes in our life, and you are saved from an accident, you are saved from a sickness, what do you say? You say, to God be the glory. Meaning, if it wasn't because of the goodness of God, if it wasn't because of the intervention of God, I wouldn't be where I am today. So the glory of God can also be revealed and reflected in the intervention of God. But the highest expression today of the glory of God is manifested in the life, death, burial, and resurrection of the Lord Jesus Christ. All right. In a nutshell, what should we remember about the glory of God? The glory of God is the presence of God. The glory of God is the power of God. The glory of God is the pleasure of God. If we can access the glory of God, then it means that God is pleased with us, that God doesn't want to destroy us. in spite of our limitations and our shortcomings, that God is pleased with us, that God knows your name, that God is happy to manifest God's self to you and sort of like expose you to God's nakedness, show you how intimate God wants to be with you. Right? God wants to be manifest to you. God wants to be revealed to you. God wants to grant access to you as God's child. This is what the glory of God represents in a nutshell. Now, based on the focus of our study, we said, so then to access the glory of God, number one, based on what we learned from scripture, if we want to access the glory of God, there has to be sacrifice. And we took our time to explain to you why sacrifice. We said because sacrifice is an indication, you know, it's that solemn ceremony of the causing of the death of an animal, you know, by the pouring out of the life of that animal, which is a means of saying, hey, I deserve to be here, but this animal is taking my place. Please be gracious and grant me access to you. Sacrifice. We said today that we don't need to sacrifice like it was done in the Old Testament. Why? Because Jesus Christ is the perfect sacrifice, right? Scripture says if the blood of bulls and of goat could take away sin, there would have been no need for Christ to die. And we said the implication, what does that mean today for us today? It does not mean that, you know, because we're in the New Testament, we can't sacrifice. But our sacrifice is a different kind of sacrifice, all right? We said our sacrifice today is, number one, the sacrifice of faith. He said, how can faith be a sacrifice? Well, if you look at Philippians chapter 2, verse 17, there you hear when Paul writes to the Philippian believers, you know, notice that the dude is writing from prison. He's in jail, right? And he could end up getting executed. He could end up having his head cut off. And while he's in prison and he's writing to them, this is what he says to them. He says, but even if I am being poured out as a libation or as a drink offering, rather, right? Over the sacrifice and the offering of your faith. So in other words, he describes their faith as a sacrifice. Their faith as a sacrifice. Faith can be a sacrifice. In Hebrews chapter 9, verse 26, for then, the scripture says, he would have had to suffer repeatedly since the foundation of the world, but as it stands, he appeared once for all at the end of the age to put away sin by the sacrifice of himself. Now, because Jesus appeared to offer himself as a sacrifice for us, it means that our faith in Jesus brings us into connection with that sacrifice. The sacrifice has power. Imagine the power like electricity. But if you want to plug into that power, if I want to plug into that power, then the wire, the cable I need to connect that power is the cable of my faith in the Lord Jesus. So faith is a sacrifice. Faith is a sacrifice, right? We says the Bible also says in Hebrews chapter 11 and verse number 4, guess what? When Abel offered a sacrifice unto God, the sacrifice wasn't just accepted with God because it was a sacrifice. No, the scripture says it was by faith that he offered to God a more acceptable sacrifice. So his faith qualified his sacrifice. I'm using this to let you know, beloved, that faith is connected. Faith and sacrifice, they're interrelated. When you choose to believe God, guess what? You are letting go of something. There is no one who believes God and don't forego something. Scripture says of Moses, when he became of age, he chose rather to suffer affliction with the people of God than to endure the pleasure of sin for a season. Genuine faith in God will always cause you to sacrifice something. And if anyone claims that you have faith in God, but you have not sacrificed something, guess what? That faith is devil faith. It's demonic faith. What do I mean by that? The scripture says, even the devil believes there is one God and he trembles with fear. But you and I know that the devil does not obey God with his faith. No, he uses the knowledge of God to manipulate the people of God, to scheme and connive and set plots and traps for the people of God to destroy them. So hence, this is the mark of distinction between those who truly have genuine sacrificial faith as those who trust God to the point that the understanding of what God has revealed to them changes them from going one direction to going in the direction God will have them go. You cannot, I cannot, we cannot say that we have faith in God. We offer the sacrifice of our faith and still live the way we used to live before that point of our faith experience and think that we are on the right course. We are on a way to destruction. We are on a way to destruction. He offered a more acceptable sacrifice because of his faith. All right. And then next, we told you about the sacrifice of surrender. Paul writes to the Roman believers in Romans chapter 12, "Beloved, I beseech you by the mercy of God that you give your bodies, you offer your body to present yourselves as a living sacrifice, holy and acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service." So the surrender of ourselves is a sacrifice. When you choose, and when you choose as a man or woman of faith, and you choose and say, because of my faith in Jesus, because God has had mercy on me, I am not going to live the life I used to live, it's going to be a sacrifice. Because sin is pleasurable. Sin, anything about sin is pleasurable, is good. We love it. We are hooked onto it. We've probably practiced it almost all of our life, and we were way advanced in years before Jesus saved us and opened our eyes to the gospel light, and we surrender and we accepted it. But still, although we try to walk in obedience to God, still the devil still puts the enticing, juicy, pleasurable, sweet, enticing sin there. So to choose to make the decision by the aid of the Spirit of God, by the grace of God, and say, I will not do this. I am presenting my body to God as a living sacrifice. It is a sacrifice. It is a hard thing to do. It is a hard thing to make time and say, I will sit down and I will read the Word of God. I will sit down and I will spend time with God in prayer. I will turn my plate over this week and I will go to God in fasting. I would learn to understand the will of God for my life, not just to have head knowledge of it, but to ask myself, how do I apply it when I go to work? When I get out of my house and I'm walking on the street? So surrender to God is a sacrifice. Paul is in prison. Philippians 2:17, we just read. Paul is in prison. He's in prison. And he's saying, you know, if he had been poured out, he knows that he could die. And the only reason why he's in prison is not because he's committed a crime, but he's in prison because of his testimony of Jesus. He says he would not deny Jesus, and he could get killed for that. The question today is, do we have this kind of faith? Do we have this kind of surrender today? The surrender of our lives, of our bodies, our minds, our thinking, our resources to grow more into the knowledge of God. Do we, you know, are we expressing, are we sacrificing ourselves, you know, as a token of thanksgiving for the mercy of God? He said, because of the mercy of God, present your bodies to God as a living sacrifice. So if we have tasted of the mercy of God, and yet we are not excited to want to surrender, then perhaps, like I said, we claim that we have a sacrifice, but our sacrifice is a demonic sacrifice. What makes it demonic? Again, the devil believes there is one God and he trembles with fear. But he does not walk in obedience. He does not walk in surrender. And then we told you about the sacrifice of praise. We told you about the sacrifice of praise. The sacrifice of praise. Hebrews chapter 13, verse 15, it says, so then, you know, then let us offer unto God, you know, the sacrifice of praise, which is the fruit of our lips. Praise to God is a sacrifice. Praise to God is a sacrifice. Praise to God is a sacrifice. And sometimes the most powerful and effective praise is the praise that says to God, Lord, it is not working for me now, but I am thanking you in advance because you promised me and you will not lie to me. The sacrifice of praise, the fruit of our lips. As I'm praising God, I'm making a confession that my circumstance and my situation doesn't look like much right now, but God is still in control. I am saying to my circumstance, I'm saying to those who are surrounding me, the great cloud of witness, I'm saying to them that my life right now may not be the best, but Jesus Christ is still Lord. And Jesus Christ still deserves my glory. I'm saying that if God causes me to have life, you know, then God's plan and God's purpose for my life is not yet over. And because God's purpose and plan for my life is not yet over, I can praise him because everything that has breath must praise the Lord. So he said, let us offer to God of the sacrifice of praise, the fruit of our lips. And I told you, the third sacrifice today in this modern New Testament era is the sacrifice of praise. So I told you first, there is a sacrifice of faith, there is a sacrifice of surrender, and there is a sacrifice of praise. But one thing I also learned as I was dealing with the sacrifice of praise, I found out that, you know, praise, you know, God is not just interested in us having the kind of praise, the verbal praise. That's not just a sacrifice. But sometimes God wants to use us to do works that will cause other people to praise God. If you go to 2 Corinthians chapter 4, verse 15, you know, after Paul talks about his partnership with the Corinthians in the gospel, he says, when you continue to do this, more people will come to know how kind God is, and they will praise and honor God. So in other words, a sacrifice of good deeds that will cause others to praise God can also be a sacrifice of praise. A sacrifice of kindness, a sacrifice of loving actions, where there's a brother or sister who is starving, who is sick, who is in need, and the Lord touches your heart and you are moved with compassion and you acted on behalf of Christ and you touched their life. And that person is saying, thank God for this sister. Thank God for this brother. What you are doing there is that by your actions, you are extending your sacrifice of praise. Meaning you are not just the only one who can praise and who can say, God, I thank you for using me to be a blessing today. No. But the other person whose life you've touched can also say, God, I thank you for this sister or for this brother. Sacrifice. If we must access the presence of God, we got to be prepared to come with a sacrifice. The second element that is critical for us to access the presence of God is the element of sanctification. The element of sanctification. What does that mean? If you took your Bible, if you took your dictionary and you checked out the word sanctification, that word means to make holy. It means to consecrate. It means to set something apart for it, for, you know, for a religious purpose, right? And so if you go to Hebrews chapter 12, we got to wrap this thing up real quick. But if you go to Hebrews chapter 12, in verse number 14, you'll see there it says, this is powerful. The writer says, pursue peace with everyone. Pursue peace with everyone and holiness, without which no man will see the Lord. That's how I know that sanctification is something that will give you access to see the glory of God. He said, if you don't pursue peace with everybody, you don't try to live in peace with everyone, if you don't strive to make peace with everyone, and if you don't seek holiness, he said, you will not see the face of God. You will not see the Lord, meaning you will not see the glory of the Lord. You will not be able to access the presence of the Lord. The word sanctification, it comes from the Latin root word sanctus, which means holy. But furthermore, when I was studying this text, that word to strive for peace, it comes from the Greek word dioko. Guess what? That word, that verb is so powerful. It's so profound. That verb means to persecute. It means to aggressively chase after, like a hunter is chasing after a prize. It means to earnestly pursue with all haste, with all eagerness, to eagerly desire to overtake and to apprehend. Wow. Strong word. It's not just, you know, they say pursue peace with all men. And so you just say, yeah, okay, but I'm pursue peace. No, it's an aggressive term. It's a term that shows, let me describe it for you. This word can be both positive and negative. If you look at what Paul was doing in the New Testament, when he was going every place with all of every fiber in his being to persecute the Christians and to shut down the church, and he was persecuting Jesus, that's the same word that is used. But he was using it in a negative sense. He was using it in a negative sense where he was seriously hunting down, persecuting, and shutting down the people of God. This is the word that he used. So when the writer says pursue peace, he means vigorously, seriously, with everything inside of us, we should pursue what? Peace with everyone and holiness. He said, because without this, we can never see the face of God. Guess why? Holiness is a this desire to see the face of God, sanctification, has a two-sided aspect. It's a two-sided coin. The first side of the coin is that no one can claim to want to desire God whom you have not seen, but at the same time, you can relate to the people on your left and on your right. That's not me saying it's a scripture. So you hear the scripture say, pursue peace with everyone. And like what Paul says in Acts chapter 26, he says, and from this moment on in my life, that means from the time I've come to a saving knowledge of Jesus Christ, he says, I exercise myself to always have a conscience void of offense towards God and man. In other words, he's saying, as much as it's in my power, I will not choose to deliberately be into any quarrel with anyone. If there's a quarrel between me and someone, if someone claims that they have a beef with me, and if it's something that I can contribute to promote peace, I would do it. They will call me a fool. They will say I'm crazy. They will say I'm foolish. They will say, what am I trying to, whatever. But I know that I'm doing it because I want to access the glory of God. Doesn't mean that people will always want to agree. No, sometimes you extend the olive branch. Over and over, you demonstrate over and over that you want to make peace. And sometimes they'll reject it. But the point is, let your heart before the Lord be clear that you are not pretending. You're not trying to show off. You desperately want to do what is right because you know that you have a God to serve and a dying soul to save. So the text says, holiness. Pursue peace with everyone and holiness, without which no man can see the face of God. I want to say something here at this point. Some of us today, we have come to the saving knowledge of Jesus Christ and we thank God that we are saved. But now we are playing God. How are we playing God? We're playing God because subconsciously in our spirits, we can't be friends with certain people because those people are too sinful for us. You say, but yeah, but I thought the Bible says, you know, evil communication corrupt good manners. Here it is. If Jesus was not going to where the sinners were, he would not have been able to influence them and touch their lives and made them to know and to see the blessing and the benefit of the presence of God in Jesus. Jesus, who is more holy than us, if Jesus could interact with sinners, you will say, but yeah, but he was strong enough to do that. So I don't want to interact with sinners so that I don't get messed up. Here it is. You were saved by grace. Grace was freely given. So grace must also be freely extended to everybody. Why? People don't care how much you know until they know how much you care. This is why. The church is a hospital. The church is a place that mitigates, that dispenses the good news of the fragrance of the kindness and the grace and the mercy of God. We can't be in the judgment seat and playing God and isolating people. No, that's not our place. God is the only one that judges. Our place is to strive to be in peace with everyone and to strive to live in holiness. You can interact with people who do certain things, but just because they do it, you don't mean you have to do it. You can, if you will be with them and maintain your testimony and stand your ground and be the person that you call that God's called you to be, let them be the ones to break away from you. But as far as you're concerned, hold your ground and love them and show them that you care for them because of the love of Jesus Christ and because of the grace that you have freely received. Now, when the word sanctify, we say sanctification, holiness, that word sanctify also means to be consecrated, or it means to be set apart for God. In Israel, every firstborn was sanctified unto the Lord, Exodus chapter 13, verse 2. The firstborn, be it from the human beings or from the cattle, the animal, every firstborn that came from the womb was consecrated unto the Lord, was dedicated to the Lord's purpose. Later on in Exodus chapter 19, verse 10 and verse 14, God instructed Moses to consecrate the whole nation of Israel. Wash their clothes. They went through a ceremonial process of literally washing themselves to show that they were now set apart. It was a physical act, a symbolic act to show a spiritual transformation that they were now washed and ready to be the people of God. Today, when we go through the process of baptism after we have given our life to Christ, it means we are also symbolically being washed, because you and I know that the physical water cannot wash away sin. So we are being washed. And as we come out not to live unto ourselves anymore, but to live unto the one who has caused us to live. We go under that water. You can't breathe underwater. So it's a symbol of you dying with Christ and rising with Christ to live a new life. And so, like I said, we can't want the presence of God and still want to live like how we chose to live, like how we were living before we met God. It's not going to work. It's not going to work. The people who are consecrated, the people of God who are consecrated, they are consecrated to live for the honor of God. They live for the thing that will make God excited, that will make God happy. Even material things can be set apart can be consecrated, can be set apart, sanctified for the purpose of God. In scripture, you see that the altar was consecrated. You see that the things in the tabernacle, in the temple, those things were consecrated unto God. There are certain things that we have too that are not revealing that ours. Because, for example, when the Bible speaks about 10% of what we have, like the tithe that is for the Lord, it comes to you. It comes to your income. But guess what? It's not yours. And the only reason why it comes to you is because God empowered you to have that opportunity. So the tithe is consecrated, is set apart. Hence, when you take it, you are taking from someone that does not, you're taking from what does not belong to you. We're talking about sanctification. So the anointing oil, even the anointing oil in the Old Testament, it was so, you know, God accepted it to the point that when it touched anything, that thing became holy. The kings were not anointed to live anyhow, to insult people, to marginalize people. No, the king was anointed to be holy unto the Lord and to promote the agenda of God, to do the will of God and to promote righteousness and justice in the land, not to be corrupt and to be wicked. So anything the oil touched, the oil consecrated. Now, quickly, what we need to understand about about sanctification is that because somebody might be wondering, but how could the oil, you know, physically consecrate anything? First of all, here it is. It was not the oil, but it was the God who prescribed the oil is the one who is doing the sanctifying, is the one who is doing the consecrating. You can present a thing to God. You can dedicate. Only God has the power to consecrate. Only God has the power to sanctify. Only if any individual, anything on the face of the earth will claim to be sanctified, it will only be sanctified because of the touch of God. One of the names of God, in fact, in the Bible is Jehovah Makadeshim. And that word means Jehovah my sanctifier. If you read Exodus chapter 31, verse 13, where God is saying to Israel, keep my statutes, observe the Sabbath, and do all of these things. Why? He said, because I am the one who sanctifies you, who consecrates you. So God is the sanctifier. So God, if we are sanctified, we only sanctify because of the touch of God, because of the grace of God. You can't make yourself sanctified. You can present yourself as a living sacrifice. And as God touches your life, God can sanctify you and make you acceptable with God. The covenant by which they entered also, that covenant also made them sanctify. Because if you look at Exodus chapter 19, verse 5 and 6, there it says, now therefore, if you will obey the voice of the Lord your God and keep my covenant, you know, then you will be my treasured possession among all the people on the earth. You will be mine. He says, and you shall be a kingdom of priests unto me, a holy nation. These are the words that you have to speak to the people of Israel. So the covenant also gave people access to becoming sanctified. And that word sanctified, again, it means to be set apart. There were other nations who lived their life doing anything, but those who entered the covenant with God, they became God's own treasured possession. And then thirdly, sanctification is also accessed through obedience, obeying the tenets of the covenant. As you see, he says, so if you were carefully, verse 5 of Exodus chapter 19, he says, if you carefully obey, now therefore, if you carefully obey the voice of the Lord, obedience to God is also the means by which they preserve their holiness. Today, the standard and the demand of God for holiness has never changed. God's standard for holiness today in this New Testament dispensation, in these last days we're in, God's standard for holiness has never changed and it will never change. God still demands that if we want to access God's glory, if we want to experience the benefits of the glory of God, the benefits of the presence of God, then holiness is a must. We can make us holy, but God must make us holy as we come to the place of realizing that we need God's intervention, God's touch in our lives. Yes, God still desires holiness, and God still desires that the people of God walk in holiness and purity of mind, purity of words, and purity of action. If we don't have purity of mind, we're still thinking bitter thoughts, angry, you know, hateful thoughts, unforgiving thoughts, foul thoughts, impure thoughts, immoral thoughts. If we're still speaking foul words, impure words, if we're still acting impure or actions that are not consistent with the covenant we have in Jesus Christ today, then maybe we need to go back for a second touch. So how do we know? How do we know today that, you know, the church, God wants the church to walk and to be sanctified? I like the way Paul put it when he talked to the Corinthian believers in 1 Corinthians chapter 1, verse 2. He says, to the church of God that is at Corinth, those who are sanctified in Christ Jesus. Now, you know that Jesus Christ is the mediator of the new covenant, right? So I told you that when you have a covenant with God, you are sanctified. When you enter the covenant with God, you become sanctified. Same concept here. He says, to the church of God that is in Corinth and to those sanctify in Christ Jesus and called to be saints. The word saints mean holy ones. So immediately when you come to Jesus and you say, Father, forgive me, accept me as your child and birth me into your family, God sanctifies you. God separates you from your past, disconnecting you from everything that made you unclean, and God now calls you a saint. You and I know that when God calls a thing, that thing, it becomes that. This is a white mug, but if God calls it a black glass, it becomes a black glass, because God will not lie. Anything God says, it becomes what God says. So when God says you are saints, it doesn't matter what you used to be before God called you that. God no longer sees you as what you used to be. God declares to you who you are and what you shall be in the future. Sanctification is the work of God. If you look at 1 Thessalonians chapter 4, from verse 3 to 8 there, he says, for this is the will of God. If you want to know what the will of God is, the will of God is holiness, that we be sanctified. Here's the word. The word of God said, for this is the will of God, your sanctification, that we abstain from sexual immorality, that each one of us know how to control our own bodies in holiness and in honor, not in the passions of lust, like the unbelievers who don't know God, that no one transgresses and wrongs your brother in this matter, because the Lord is the avenger of all those who do such things. And we have told you beforehand, and we solemnly have warned you. For God has not called us to impurity, but God has called us to holiness. Therefore, if anyone refuses or disregards this word, this instruction, they are not disobeying God. They're not disobeying us, but they're disobeying God who gives the Holy Spirit to us. So if we will access the glory of God, then sanctification, walking, pursuing after holiness and peace with God, is something that must be a reality. I got to close with this. If you remember nothing out of the study today, if there's one thing that you want to remember, this is the glory of God is the exposure. It's God showing us God's holy presence and God showing us God's work that brings us into true fellowship with God. The glory of God is God showing to us God's holy presence and God showing us his work that God has done to bring us into fellowship with God's self. This is what the glory of God is. And so, if God will put God's self through the process of doing all the hard work just to bring us into fellowship with God, then it means that unless we too have an aggressive hunger, an aggressive passion, an aggressive desire as a people of God to be at peace with everyone and to walk in fellowship with God, then it means that we will miss the glory of God. We cannot experience the glory of God today and the benefits that the glory brings. God has put himself through a whole lot. God has invested a lot, made a lot of investment for you, for me. And so if we want to access this glory and the benefit that God, that comes with it, number one, sacrifice. We told you about the different types of sacrifice, the sacrifice of faith, the sacrifice of surrender, and the sacrifice of praise. But number two, sanctification, being set apart, pursuing after the holiness of God. We'll talk about two more, and we'll be with this. The other that we're going to talk about that gives us access to the glory of God, number one, or number three, is surrender. That means I am available, God. And then number four is service. That means I'm not just available, but I'm actively involved in doing the work of God. And I will show you how that is connected to the glory of the Lord. So we bless God for the opportunity we've had today to share. We are grateful to God for the opportunity God has given to us to share. We thank God so much for all of the beautiful comments. Unfortunately, the comments were not really showing up, you know, for us to be able to share them on the screen. But we are still grateful to God for all of the comments. If there's a question, I can answer it. Sister Russell, Marilyn Russell is saying yes, amen. Minister Marty Phillips is saying amen. Big Sister Willetia is saying amen, Reverend. Yes, she says, Sister Willard Pine is saying teach. Yes, amen. Sister Selma Griffiths saying yes. Brother Bayan is saying that's right. Make me whatever you want me to be, all right? That's just from the song, Praise the Lord. I'm just trying to check to see if there's any question. If there's any question here. Hey, Pastor Papa is on here. Duna Papa, man of God, I bless God for you. He says amen. Sister Selena Roberts is also here. I was just checking to see if there are any questions, if there's any question for us to answer, so we can try to address it as quickly as we can and then wrap it up. Praise the Lord. So for us to access the glory of God, is, first of all, through the medium of sacrifice. If you want God, you got to give up something. God wanted me until God gave up his only begotten son, John 3:16, sacrifice. Number two, sanctification. You can't want to walk with God and still, the scripture says we can't want to eat from the table of God and want to eat from the table of the devil at the same time. Light and darkness can't have the same fellowship. There has to be a mark of distinction. And here it is. Don't let this frighten you though, because it's not about perfection on this side of eternity, because we know the Bible says, we don't know what Jesus Christ is like, but we know when he appears, we shall be like him. So what is it about? It is about intentional progress. That means I'm going to learn to press forward, press hard. I know I'm not what I ought to be yet, but I know that I'm not what I used to be, and I'm going to continue to keep pressing hard after God. That's what it means. That's what sanctification is all about. It's about constantly striving to be the best I can be for God. Constantly striving to walk in obedience to God, to do and to be the person God wants me to be. So first of all, we told you about sacrifice, and then we told you about sanctification. If the Lord blesses us, we will tell you about surrender. How can surrender expose you to the glory of God? And how can service expose you to the glory of God? I don't see any questions. And so we just give God glory. If you got any prayer points, you can also share those prayer points you want us to pray about, and we'll pray about it. Not just here, but we'll continue to pray about it even after this time, and then we'll be dismissed. Is there anything you would like us to pray about? Do you have any particular prayer concern you would like us to pray about? If you have any concern that you would like us to pray about, it would be an honor for us to pray with you. Praise the Lord. And we bless Jesus. We bless the Lord. I'm just waiting to see if there are any prayer concerns out here. Any prayer concerns quickly, and then we're going to use that to pray and be done. This is a song by Miranda Curtis. You already know I love this song. Open Heaven. We have no copyright to this song. But since we're talking about accessing the glory of God, I believe it's an appropriate song for us to just plead with God to cause God's glory to be upon us, to cause God's heaven to be open over us.
In open heaven, when his glory shall be revealed. When sin sick soul shall heal. We are under an open heaven. We are under an open heaven.
Hallelujah, Jesus. We bless you, Jesus. We bless you, Jesus. All right, let's pray. Let's thank God. Father, we thank you, Lord, today for your word. We thank you that your word is life. And that your word will correct us and speak to the issues of our lives so that, God, we can be the people you've created us to be. The circumstances and the situation that we're not willing to confront, God, we can never conquer. We can never overcome. And so if your word seems to be challenging to us, it's not because you hate us, but because you want to deliver us and give us better. So, Lord, we say thank you for your word today. We pray, Spirit of God, that you will give us a mind. You will change our mindset, not to always want to be on the end of receiving, but to be a giving people. To be a sacrificial people, because God, we cannot access your presence if we're not willing to sacrifice something. And oh God, we pray tonight that God, you will also create in us a hunger for holiness. You will create in us a thirst for holiness, oh God. You want us to be set apart. This is your will for us. This is your word. So God, help us tonight. And where we fall short tonight, we're not embarrassed to admit before you, because we know that only as we come to you that, God, we can find mercy, oh God. So, Lord, we need your glory tonight. We need your strength. We need your cleansing. We need your power. We need your showers tonight, oh God. Help us, oh God, to be the people you've created us to be. Thank you for each and every person who tuned into this broadcast tonight. And we pray for them, oh God, in their unique lives and in their own individual walk with you, oh God. Whatever the circumstance or the situation is in their life that they're struggling with, I pray that your eyes will pull strong on their behalf to grant unto them deliverance, breakthrough, favor, because you will not fail us, God. Let the presence, let us begin to taste the presence of God. Let us begin to taste the glory of God. Let the glory, the presence, and the power of God come over our lives with all of the fullness of heaven, oh God. And somebody can say, God, I thank you for your glory upon my life. Your glory distinguished me. Your glory made a difference in my family. Your glory marked my home for deliverance. When other people were being touched, the glory of the Lord made a difference in my life. Let it be, O God, over us tonight. Thank you for signs and wonders. Accompany your word with signs and wonders in the lives of your people. And we thank you, Lord, because you will do just that and more. For you are able to do all that we can ask or imagine. Thank you, Lord. We bless you. We glorify you now in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Thank you. Thank you so much. Thank you so much for joining us again. It's a privilege. It's an honor for us to be here. God willing, we'll be on the through the same meeting. We'll come your way again on Sunday for our FIVs online worship. We pray that you can be a part of our worship experience, and we pray that there will be a word that God will, you know, bless you, and there will be a time of praise and prayer, and we pray that through this media, you will be blessed. If you feel led and you want to participate in giving to this ministry, in supporting this ministry through your gifts, through your finances, the contact information is on the screen. It's on the bottom of the screen, 609-222-2509. If you can cash app to that number, it will come directly to the church, to our treasurer, and the church will write you a letter to acknowledge the receipt of your gift and to say thank you to you. Listen, no amount is too small, no amount is too big. Whatever God impresses on your heart to sow into this ministry, to give to this work, so that we continue doing what we do for God. If you do it, we want to assure you that God, heaven will recognize it. God will be gracious, will rejoice over you concerning your sacrifice, and it will be properly accounted for and used for the glory and the honor of God. We love you. Thank you for your support. Thank you for being there. May the word of God dwell richly in your heart. And may the power of the word come alive in your circumstances and the situation and show you that serving the Lord is not a wasted effort. God bless you. God keep you in Jesus' name. Amen.